On this episode of Cuesta Dose, my brother David and I delve into a little bit shorter of topics this week, but we, you know, I go on two rants, so that's fun. We talk about the XFL, which we've been touting since its beginning, and the first week happened, and we talk about our impressions and what we think about it. We talk about the NBA trade deadline, a few trades that piqued our interest and what we think about them. I go on a rant against everyone that doesn't want Pete Rose in the MLB and in the Hall of Fame. Talk about the Mets and their failure to sell to Stephen Cohen and what went down with that deal. And then you get a bonus special rant on me talking about the Knicks. So without any further ado, enjoy the show. One is the loneliest number that you'll ever do. Two can be as bad as one. It's the loneliest number since the number one. What's going on, sports fans? Welcome to Cuesta Dose. I'm Alex. My brother David is somewhere in the ether there. How are you, David?
Hey, man. I'm somewhere. Maybe I'll be gone for a little bit, and I'll come back. Maybe we'll find me throughout the episode.
You're in the swamps and salt waters of central Jersey. Ooh, it does exist. Ooh.
No, I mean, the NJ at says it exists, so...
Listen, if New Jersey Twitter says it exists, if Bon Jovi says it exists, and I'm going to butcher his name, but K-Doc had his guest on We're Young But Just Us, the co-creator Deadpool. He's a New Jersey guy, and he said Central Jersey exists. Central Jersey exists, okay?
We're putting that down. I mean, right. I really don't care too much. I just consider us the shores, so.
Yeah, but you can't do that because then everyone says, oh, I'm going down to the shore. I'm going down to the shore. I don't want to be the shore.
I don't care.
You need to care. Get passionate, David. Get passionate. So this week, we have a little more of a truncated episode because bottom line, David, we're exhausted. We have other jobs.
Well, you're more tired than me.
I am. I am very tired. I had a long day today. We're recording a day later because yesterday on Monday where we normally record, me and you kind of were just, I didn't feel well. You were exhausted and we were both just kind of like, yeah, no. So we're recording on a Tuesday. It's February 11th. And we're going to get right into it though, because I talked about having passion. First topic, David, you have passion about this.
I sure do.
We have possibly been two of the biggest proponents for this league to exist. And since it was announced, you've been excited about the XFL. Since its announcement, we had week one. It happened, Dave. There were no wrestlers. There were no cheap gimmicks. There was just a whole lot of football. Dave, the floor is yours. Give me your impressions on week one of the XFL.
All right, so it's a good thing. It's perfect timing that Valentine's Day is on Friday because now I get to show my love for this new league. Now, we kind of did the same thing with the AAF. And we hyped it up a little bit because we want to talk about it. I mean,
and
for
we
me,
failed. We failed.
Hey, listen, it happens. I come into these things.
Hey, quick thing. We did choose the eventual champions, Orlando Apollos, by default.
That is true. That is true. They were a great team in that league. But anyway, yeah. See, these things, I come into them. I love football, and I love seeing people try new things and open these businesses up because it's not easy. This is not easy. It's a hard task. It's an arduous thing. Yeah, they're doing it for profit, but we also get to see spring football. I know a lot of people would love to see it. So, AAF failed, but the XFL opened up this weekend. And for those who watched, pretty sure it seems like most of you, including me, including you, enjoyed what we saw. It looked like professional football. The presentation was very good, from the commentators to all the camera angles.
To Pat McAfee just being Pat McAfee and being awesome.
To the sideline reporters. He was a sideline reporter. That is one of the most interesting things.
To Troy Aikman almost getting run over.
That is one of the most interesting things I've ever seen in my life. The fact that the guy misses a field goal and you automatically go up and ask him about it. That's incredible.
How do you feel? You know, that is, it's a weird, it's gimmicky, but at the same time, it's interesting. I want to know how it's going to go because you know what? Week one, everyone's excited. Players are willing to do it. Everyone's willing to do it. When you're going to that 0-whatever team and they're struggling and that player misses a fingertip catch that could have changed the game, gotten them that first win of the season, and then a microphone gets sprung on their face when they get to the sideline. What are we going to hear then? Or are they even going to do it?
Well, I mean, I'm certain that before they even did the interview, they basically asked the player, are you willing to do this? Are you willing to talk right now? And they'll say yes. And this is the first week, so they're just figuring things out, and they were trying something out that they think would go well with people, and it did. For the most part, people enjoy it. Obviously, there was some mixed reception, but for the most part, they enjoyed it. Another thing people enjoyed was transparency. The referees, seeing how they called the plays, that happened in the AAF too, people loved it there as well. Something the NFL might end up stealing one day. But also, the head coach comms and, like, the quarterback stuff, like, that was pretty cool hearing their plays. I think it gets a little weird because I don't know how many head coaches are going to love people hearing their plays after a while.
They're going to have to change up so much week to week.
That's what I'm saying. It's so difficult for all the teams in general. Yeah, that is one of the prime cons of that. But yet again, they all agree to it. So obviously they're thinking of some ways around it. Another thing, I don't know if the NFL does this already, but every single wide receiver and running back, every single skill player had a comm in their helmet.
They don't. The only players that have comms in the NFL, as far as my knowledge is, the quarterback has it in his helmet until the 22nd mark of the play clock. So they have from 40 to 20. I believe it's like 20 seconds. And then they get to designate one player on the defense, normally the middle linebacker, to get it, I think, for the same amount of time. Besides that, 10 other guys on either side of the ball are blind.
Yeah, because you could see it like when everyone was getting ready, like when every time an offense was getting ready and hearing the plays, you saw every single wide receiver and quarterback and running back hold their hands up to their head to hear the play, to hear it getting called. And I guess, you know, you have to do that when you have 25-second play clocks.
And even six of the defensive players had it as well, so they were able to make the defensive adjustments, which you mentioned, the 25-second play clock. This is a way to make this league work and that speed work, because in the NFL – with the 40-second play clock, I think if you give everyone mics, it's a lot of time for them to play chess.
Yeah.
Where in the XFL, the 25-second play clocks, it's enough for them to get the play, understand it, make the adjustments, and call hike. It's a different game, and I like the way the XFL did that.
Yeah. I've seen a lot of people actually really love the new kickoff rule. In fact, most of them think the NFL is going to steal that in the future because it's 100% safer. It honestly looks stupid. It looks really weird, but it works. Like, you get big plays out of it, and you get penalized if you don't have a kick return happen. It's the same thing for a punt. You really get penalized for it because they get it at the 35 instead of the 20. So, obviously, their rules for bigger offense for this league and make it easier has worked throughout the weekend. You can see, like, most of the scores, there's good scoring going up there, except for like the Guardians game and, well, the two Sunday games, honestly. But you see, everyone knew what they were doing. That extra year that they took to make sure everything was implemented correctly worked out perfectly. Honestly, in my opinion, they got 3.3 million viewers all weekend. Great numbers for them. For a startup league, that's great numbers. I think three out of the four games beat the NBA in viewership, and that is fantastic if you're Vince McMahon.
And I saw a number, Dave, that the first game of the XFL season matched the AAF first game, and the AAF was on primetime.
Yeah.
The first game for the XFL was at 2 o'clock on a Saturday.
Yeah.
That, you know, we have to see in week two because
to be able to continue.
Yes. People need to be able to continue to be interested. Now, one thing that I liked, and one thing that I think will keep people's interest, Dave, I saw competent offensive line play.
Yes.
I didn't see the defensive linemen and the defense, and, you know, I didn't see defensive coordinators rushing six every single time because they knew the offense was outmatched. Because that's what eventually happened in the AAF.
Yep.
In the AAF, they understood the offensive linemen were not together. They were not very good. And they just bum rushed them. And you saw quarterbacks getting killed. And guys got hurt. They couldn't afford the compensation. It snowballed from there. Mm-hmm. What I saw from the XFL is, yes, there was a good amount of scrambles. Yes, you know, the sacks happened. But it wasn't anything more than you would see on a college Saturday or an NFL Sunday. You saw some pretty good pockets being created. You saw quarterbacks being able to step up. And also on top of that, Dave, you saw competent quarterback play. You saw adjustments 100% at the line.
Matt McGloin called so many adjustments at the line.
Between Matt McGloin and even Aaron Murray early on, that was a pretty good quarterback duel in the beginning. And then you have Flowers coming in late for Tampa Bay where they were already getting beaten. But you heard the commentary saying if Flowers was in all game, what could that have been? That would have been a much more competitive game because he had the Guardians very off balance late in that game.
Yes. Yes, he did. And honestly, if you watch the XFL, you saw competent football. One of the things that surprised me the most was the fact that, you know, it's 25-second play clocks. Everything's moving very quickly. Luckily, they have just one guy that spots the ball after every play. That's
the red hat.
Fantastic idea. Yeah, they know exactly who it is. He has a red hat, or he or she has a red hat. They run out, put the ball down, take the other one, put it in their bag, whatever. Get it going, get it quickly going. And the one thing that surprised me and impressed me was that you really didn't see many like delay of games, many of these penalties that would happen when you're ill prepared to go out there and play. They definitely looked prepared and ready to put on a game for the people in attendance. And by the way, this is unconfirmed numbers, but if you watch the games, you saw they filled out the stadium not badly for the seats that they sold.
I think it was a little bit over 17,500 people per game.
For like each, yes, each for game. Each game. And that's pretty damn good. To that's get people solid. To go out to spring football, that's a good number. This opening weekend really couldn't have gone much better for them.
It couldn't have gone much better, and I think it was a really good start for the XFL. It's really encouraging. I'm excited for week 2. But then again, me and you were both homers for football. We were excited for week 2 of AAF. And, you know, and AAF tanked pretty quickly after week 2. But all things considered, the signs look better for the XFL. And the bottom line is, Vince McMahon isn't hurting for money. He's not hungry for money. The ultimate fall for the AAF was bad O-line play and no money for hotels, workman's comp, injuries, the basic things that these players need. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Vince McMahon's not worried about any of that.
Yeah, and they obviously got a good amount of sponsors. I mean, they have Bud Light Seltzer. They have Bud Light sponsoring them very heavily. You could see that. The Battle Hawks had a whole Bud Light Seltzer shotgun party after they won, and that was amazing to see. Like, you can see that they're having fun in this league. I hope it works out because it looks like a fun time. It looks like it could stick as long as it doesn't start getting incompetent.
And the last thing I noticed, Dave, and it might be a little bit picky of me, but they looked professional, even down to their uniforms and down to the things that the coaches were wearing. You know, it wasn't flashy. It wasn't over the top. It looked professional. A lot of the coaches just had on pullovers with their logo and a hat.
Yeah.
The uniforms themselves, you know, we saw them with prototypes, but seeing them in action.
Honestly,
the most Madden-looking one was the Dallas Renegades. And that uniform put together didn't look bad at all.
I love those uniforms, honestly. The Renegades one, I love those. And Battle Hawks, those are smooth.
But I'm not going to lie, the Guardians uniforms, watching them on them, just that helmet looks great.
It looks good, yeah.
It's marketable. When you have things like that are marketable, logos and jerseys and things like that are marketable, one of the things that AAF is, it didn't look marketable, Dave.
Yeah.
A lot of the things looked very, you know, if you're looking at it, that was MS Paint, and this is Adobe Photoshop in terms of, like, the quality. And that's the best way I could put it. So here's to hoping the XFL stays, Dave.
Yeah, and just one more thing. The only thing that they weren't able to show off, because they showed off basically every one of their rules, the only thing that they weren't able to show off was their overtime. And I know that at one point they're going to want to see how exactly it plays out in an actual game.
Yep, and the 3-point extra point, but I think that'll happen eventually
That's going to happen. That's going to happen, but overtimes are going to be harder to come by.
And it'll happen more when the coaches adjust, because a lot of coaches came from NFL background where it was go kick your extra point or attempt 2.
Yep.
And now there is no kicking the extra point, so the strategy is different. So I think as coaches adjust, that'll also become different. But we're going to adjust in this podcast, and we're going to swing all the way from football and kind of unorthodox football because it's the XFL, over to orthodox basketball, the NBA. And the trade deadline just came and passed, and there were a few big trades that I wanted to talk to you about and kind of pick your brain about. Mentioning the three biggest ones to me, Andre Iguodala gets away from the Memphis Grizzlies and goes over to the Heat. The Heat gets stacked a little more. Cleveland gets Andre Drummond. Drummond's out of Detroit, and it's kind of funny that they're running away a guy that you really like. And as much as I say his position is kind of a dinosaur in the NBA, he's still a very good player. And then D'Angelo Russell goes to the T-Wolves, and Andrew Wiggins goes to Golden State. I hate the fact that D'Angelo Russell's a journeyman, but I love that situation that he's in now. And also, it's a good situation for Wiggins. Which of those three has the biggest winner, Dave?
The biggest winner?
Yeah, who's the biggest winner in terms of where they went team-wise? Who has the biggest win?
Teams that made... I want to say Andrew Wiggins.
Really?
The reason why I want to say Andrew Wiggins, because he really looked like a bust for a while. He's honestly been having a very good year this year. A lot of people have seen the turnaround he's had. He looks like he cares. But a lot of people had high hopes for him, and he started looking like a bust. With this trade, obviously, it probably gets a little annoying to get traded. But with this trade, he's out of that environment. He's over to the Warriors. You can say whatever you want about Steve Kerr, but that's a winning environment over there. You have Steph Curry. You have Klay Thompson, not playing right now, but they're still around there. You have and Draymond, another winner. You have people that will hold him accountable, that will help him get better. And honestly, the sky could be the limit for him. We've seen him go off in multiple games. It just seems like it almost seems like he needs to. I want to say he needs to care a bit more, even though a lot of people probably would say that. But I think going over to the Warriors, getting that new environment, getting around those players will help him drastically.
You know, I agree. But it is tough to swallow Andrew Wiggins, because if we go back to his draft class, Dave, I remember comparisons to Carmelo Anthony and LeBron James class between Jabari Parker and Andrew Wiggins.
Oh, I know. Yeah, I know.
I remember sitting there, and I don't want to put him on blast, but I love putting him on blast. The Playbook's Rob Planter was one of the first guys that, when that came back, was saying, you know, I'm not going to say he said they were there, because he's going to call me out for this. But he was one of the ones jumping on the bandwagon that the potential was there for them to be, you know, this class to be as good as that class. And don't get me wrong, that's a class that had Joel Embiid, Andrew, Aaron Gordon, Julius Randle, Zach LaVine. There was a lot of really good players to come out of that class. Nikola Jokic. But all those guys I just mentioned are better than Andrew Wiggins and Jabari Parker. Jabari Parker doesn't exist right now. So it's just interesting to see the development. Now, for me, I really like that Iggy went over to the Heat, because Jimmy Butler does need some help over there. The Heat's a very good team. He's carrying them. And Tyler Hero is a very good upstart. But you now add...
Well, he needed the vet help.
But you add one of the best wing defenders as well. Yeah, wing defenders in the NBA between him and Jimmy Butler.
And don't forget Jay Crowder, man.
And Jay Crowder's a very good veteran addition.
Don't forget Jay Crowder.
A good three-point shooter, a good veteran, scrappy guy. But when it comes playoff time, they can now take Jimmy off the best guy. Normally, early in Jimmy's career, and even, when he was with the Bulls and everything, he covered the best wing player, because he's one of the better wing defenders in the NBA. I don't know how many times I watched Jimmy Butler cover LeBron when it was the Bulls versus the Cavs, and give LeBron fits, not Kawhi level, but still really good. Iggy is another guy that can give LeBron fits. And no doubt his length, if the Heat meet up with the Bucks, is going to be a major factor in switching him and Jimmy off onto Giannis Antetokounmpo. And even if you go down the groups there, with the Raptors, Pascal Siakam, two long guys that can cover him. Even the Celtics, Jason Tatum, Jaylen Brown, they can both kind of, they're not going to stop these guys, but they can deter these guys and change the game. I really think that's big. I think adding Iggy and Jay Crowder to the Heat makes them a bigger contender to the Bucks than anybody else in the East.
Yeah, no, it definitely makes them a better team. It makes them have that vet experience that could help them throughout the playoffs. No doubt, especially with defending and everything. And I it's a great trade for the Heat. It's Pat Riley obviously wants to win now. He's making these trades to win now. Now, I still think the Bucks win in the East, but the Heat are a much more formidable team now, especially since Jimmy's a closer. Jimmy can close out any damn game he wants to.
Now, quick question about Jimmy. If they sit there, if he carries his Heat team ahead of the Celtics, the Raptors, the Sixers, and the teams that are there, even meets the Bucks in the Eastern Conference Finals, not necessarily wins them, are we going to really talk about this guy as a superstar? He seems to be one of the most disrespected superstars in the NBA.
He 100% is. And I genuinely don't understand how people forgot how good Jimmy Butler is.
Because he was there during the D-Rose era, and everyone, I think, really just puts everything on D-Rose.
But after the D-Rose era, he was still there holding down Chicago. He was still great over there, so I don't really get that.
And even on the Sixers team last year, when they wanted to win, they didn't go to Joel Embiid. They didn't go to Ben Simmons or Tobias Harris.
It was Jimmy Butler. Yeah, no, it was Jimmy Butler. He did. Listen, he went to the Timberwolves. They're all a bunch of babies. Jimmy Butler doesn't play like that. He has that mentality where he's a dog. He's going to make you better. And they didn't want to go with Jimmy Butler. So he goes over to Sixers. He's a dog. Brett Brown said he's the adult in the room. Why does he have to be the only adult? So now he goes over to Heat. A lot of young players, you would think the same thing would happen. No, they want to win so Jimmy Butler can actually mesh with these people. And you can see how good of a team there can be around him when you buy into his attitude.
So has he scraped off this locker room cancer thing that he got after one issue?
He's not a locker room cancer.
No, listen, he wants to win.
Exactly. Exactly. That's the whole thing. He's not a locker room cancer. He does what he needs to win. And you could see it. He believes he legitimately believes he can be anyone on that court. Whether you think he can or not, he believes he can. Then he goes out and he shows how good he is every single night he plays.
Yeah. I think I was one of the people. I think you were one of the people that when Jimmy Butler was even in talks of being traded to the Nets, we were both like, yes, yes.
Yeah.
Bring Jimmy to the Nets. Bring him to the Nets. Could you imagine his attitude with Brooklyn grit? Could you imagine him? I enjoy watching Kyrie play. He hasn't been healthy, but Kyrie is fantastic for the Nets. But could you imagine Spencer Dinwiddie and Jimmy Butler and the chip on both of those guys' shoulders?
Oh yeah,
Brooklyn, Jesus Christmas.
Yeah. All right, but let's get to these other trades real quick, just because I want to talk about Drummond and D'Lo amount of time. Drummond. Like you noted, I still think he's a very good player. He's a very good center. And like, you know, you saying the center is down, whatever. I don't care about you.
But he gets traded to Cleveland.
Well, I don't know why he got traded to Cleveland. Because the Detroit Pistons don't know how to build a team. That's why he got traded to Cleveland. Because the Detroit Pistons, I have to say this again, they paired up Blake Griffin and Andre Drummond. What is wrong with you? You got no backcourt over there. Luke Kennard is one of your best players. What is wrong with this team? That's why he got traded to Cleveland, because they needed something, because they're rebuilding again.
One thing that annoys me is he goes to Cleveland. Kevin Love is still there. Tristan Thompson's still there. He's probably going to start over Tristan Thompson. But this puts Kevin Love back in the predicament that he had, where he's now an outside guy again. When Kevin Love was at his best, he was on the block. He could shoot the three, and there would be times where he'd go crazy from the three. But he does his work from 16 feet in. With Andre Drummond being there, it's just a big body standing within 5 feet waiting for a rebound and a putback. Kevin Love's going to have to spread the floor again. And it makes me sad that we will not get to see superstar Kevin Love probably ever again in his career because of the stigma of being an outside shooter now.
Hey, man, it's unfortunate, but it's what happens. It happens sometimes, and it's really unfortunate, but we all know Kevin Love is Mr. Double-Double still a little bit. We understood what he was and what he is now. But hopping real quick to D'Lo.
Hop, like skip, you said, and a jump.
Yeah, exactly. I don't like that he looks like a journeyman right now, like you said. But
so talented.
Exactly. But I think this Minnesota angle is going to stick for a long time, especially with him and Kat. They're just going to want to build around those two. They want to build around Kat. So they gave him D'Lo, his best friend. And now they can play together. And then they can maybe build a team around him. And they could be actually dangerous, that team, if they could make the right moves and get the right players.
You know, and it makes me sad, bringing up the Nets, because we have to do every single podcast we do. Watching some of the games this year, did it come into your mind, Dave? Like, Kyrie's been hurt a lot, so it's not like we could see, like, Kyrie closing time. And I think we both believe in Spencer closing, but there have been times in the end of the third, fourth quarters, where I'd be going, man, this is D'Lo takeover time. This is the time last year where D'Lo would look at certain games, Nets will be down by five or maybe up by four and dwindling the lead, and he would come in and go, I'm just going to hit three threes in a row. And that's it. And we're going to, you know, stake our claim, and that's going to be it. I do miss D'Lo in Brooklyn. I'm happy with Kyrie, but I miss D'Lo in Brooklyn. And really happy he could be in a good situation right now.
No, I definitely miss him because he grew up in Brooklyn, really. He grew up as a player into a star in Brooklyn. So I do miss him for that, for that reason. He's very good. He can close out games. But, I believe Kyrie can close out games better than D'Lo. I'm not going to lie to you. He can. There is a part of me that definitely misses him. But I think it was better for him to move on because, you know, it's either he stayed with the Nets and we maybe build a team around him. Because I don't know if we were going to get that high of a seed. But now he can go to Minnesota and he can be with his best friend. He can play with his best friend and he can play the basketball that he wants to play. So I'm happy for him. I feel like it still was for the best.
It makes me sad because I look at Brook Lopez in Milwaukee and he's one of my favorite players. And D'Lo quickly became one of my favorite players in Brooklyn. And I'm happy for both of them, but I really don't want either of them to win until the Nets win. Even though it looks like Brook's going to get a championship before the Nets. That's okay.
That's fair.
All right. We done with trades, Dave?
Yeah, we're done with trades. Unfortunately, usually I like to try to tie in the last thing we talk about to the next thing we talk about, but I can't.
No, there's nothing really to tie in here.
There really isn't much.
We ended off on a happy note. This is kind of an annoying note.
This is annoying, though. But if anyone paid attention to the news about baseball topics, you might have seen that Pete Rose applied for reinstatement because basically outlining, hey guys, how come everyone else didn't get the same treatment I did?
Come the Astros get a pass and exactly. I'm still banned for life?
Exactly. That's what he's saying. He's like, oh, what? This makes no sense that I get banned for life and steroid users and the Astros cheating like they did, all those players, they get nothing. I'm banned for life.
For betting on myself to win.
And they get nothing.
He bet on, you know what? And everyone's like, betting. You know, the baseball purists, betting is illegal in any form. These are probably the same people that believe that, like, politicians don't inside bet inside the Congress. But anyway, he bet on himself to win. I would understand if he bet on, like, the Reds to lose. The dude was always throwing his money on, I'm Pete Rose, I'm the best, and we're going to win games because of me. And I've never watched a man play in person, but if you watch highlights, there's not a single moment where that guy wasn't going at 120%.
Yeah. Listen, I can understand wanting to make an example out of him. I can understand doing that, but you gotta let it go, especially when you're not doing the same thing to other players. You just aren't. You got soft, MLB. That's what happened. Apparently, you got soft. So yes. If you're gonna be soft, then let the man back in.
Dave, you ready for this? You wanna know why? And I'm going to go on my rant.
Okay, here you go.
Because the idiot baseball writers, the same morons that get to decide Hall of Fame votes off of petty relationships that they may or may not have had with players, are the same idiots that, you know, whether he gets reinstated or not, will still not vote him into the Hall of Fame. And that's where the thing is. I think whatever commissioner brings him back in wants to bring him back in with the assurance that he's going to go into the Hall of Fame as well. Because what's the point of bringing him back into baseball if he can't go in the hall where he belongs? So this comes down to the exact morons that were still alive when he played, remembering how he really took the integrity of the game and stepped on it. These idiots. And I don't, you know, these are guys that I love to have writers and great people on my show, Sports Opinions Podcast. I never need to have any of these writers on. If you are a baseball voter and you vote against Pete Rose, I never want to have you on my show. You're an idiot. And if I ever go to a function where I'm, you know, fortunate enough to go there and you've heard of me and you've heard me call you an idiot, I will tell you you're an idiot to your face. And I'll probably promptly be kicked out of that function. But that's okay because you're an idiot. Absolutely. If Pete Rose finds a way to outlive all of these morons, then maybe he'll get in, he'll get reinstated. The problem is these idiot baseball writers are still alive. These idiot baseball writers will not vote him in off of false senses of integrity and their own self-righteousness. And unfortunately, one of the top probably 15 or 20 players in the history of the game is still not in the Hall of Fame and still not back in baseball because of idiots. I digress, Dave.
You good? You good?
They are stupid idiots.
All right, well, I mean, I don't have much else to say. You kind of covered everything you needed to cover, and I mean, I did too.
I mean, you can call them morons too if you want.
And there's no reason.
Dummies.
Yeah, there's no reason. I think they would get the gist. Everyone jerks, gets the gist.
Fake royalty, hypocrites. We could just go down the list. Go down the list.
All right. I think we understand. Jerks. I think we do.
Stupid
but
jerks.
But we can tie this in to other baseball morons if you would like to.
Yeah, speaking of stupid.
you go ahead, man.
The Mets will Mets as long as the Mets exist. Granted, this has nothing to do with the Mets players. This has nothing to do with the Mets fans. This has nothing to do with the Mets front office, really. This is Mets ownership. So my first impression, the deal with Stephen Cohen, who is a legitimate billionaire, unlike the Wilpons who lost all their money to Bernie Madoff and being in a scandal. Stephen Cohen, a legitimate billionaire, they were in a deal to buy the team. He was going to get full control or majority control in 5 years. They couldn't use his money within these 5 years, the Wilpons. And he didn't like that. He wanted the deal to be expedited. And the Wilpons didn't like the change of the deal. So they balked, and the deal is off. And now Mets fans need to live with the Wilpons, pretending that New York City is a small market once again. This is the most Mets thing ever, and I feel bad for Mets fans. Because if you were a Mets fan, you had to have hope that you had this guy who was buying the team, coming in, saying, this is New York City. I've been a lifelong Mets fan. This is not a small market. I have the money to spend, and I'm going to spend it on anything. I don't care about a luxury tax. Let's make a contender. And then the deal's in place. Yes, he was a little brash. Yes, he wanted it quicker. And then the Wilpons. And they were like, we hate our fans. We've hated our fans for years. We hate everything about them. We hate them so much that we allowed Jason Bay to happen. We hate them. So no, deal's off. And now they're going to find a new buyer. Who the hell wants to buy this team after that? Why? Why would you want to buy this team?
I don't know. maybe they will. Listen, for the hope of Mets fans, I hope someone does. Because, look, you get to choose who you're a fan of, but you really don't want to. You don't want to jump ship from your old fanship. Like, you don't want to jump ship from the
Mets
team that
fans
you
are insanely loyal.
Exactly. That's what
they're
saying.
They're like us. Well, most Mets fans are Jets fans, and we're all idiots. Me and you aren't Mets fans, we're Jets fans. We feel their pain.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying. Like, you're loyal. You're not going to jump ship. Obviously, you're upset. And you know this team is not going to provide for you. But you're loyal. You're not going to jump. And it just sucks. So I hope that someone does buy them from the Wilpons. Because, listen, as much as we might like to make fun of them, every fan deserves their day, at least a little bit. No one likes seeing a team.
They went to the World Series like 4 years ago.
That's true. But
what do you mean deserves their day? And also, fun fact, so we can make fun of them a little more. Their new manager, Luis Rojas, today says he expects a contender. Chew on that.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like,
chew on that.
There is no up. There really isn't an upward streak here. That's what I'm saying. Like, no one likes to see the team. I don't know how to put this because people do like to see teams tank if they're in a division and stuff like that. But you want competition. If there's no competition out, it just gets boring at one point.
I'm on record wanting the Mets to succeed until their fans start talking. I'm okay with the Mets being good until they're like 3 games over 500 and Mets fans all of a sudden start making fun of Yankees fans because they're at 500. Knowing that come playoff time, the Yankees are going to be 20 games over and the Mets game will be 14 games under. But they still do it. I'm happy for Mets and Mets fans until the Mets actually get good because they don't know how to handle it. Like, I'm sorry.
It's fair. It's fair. I don't know. I just like seeing a lot of competition. I don't like porous teams.
I'm okay with it because As long as the Mets keep on providing me entertaining stuff, I'm okay with it. Also, side caveat, Dave, that I did not throw on our little itinerary, but I have to talk about this because I have to squash Knicks fans as often as possible because I have nothing against the Knicks. I mean, I have nothing against their fans either. I just have against their stupid fans, which they have many of stupid people. So it came out today, the Forbes listed the top franchises in the NBA, right? You saw that report, I think, Dave.
Yeah.
Our resident friend Matt Santos posted it in there to make fun of Colton because the Knicks are ahead of the Lakers.
Yeah.
I think it goes Knicks, Lakers, Warriors for the top three.
Yes.
Let's put this out there. The Knicks being valued at the highest has nothing to do with their play. It has nothing to do with anything else besides the fact that they play Madison Square Garden, and we've said this before, the stupid fan base. Stop buying tickets. Stop buying merchandise if you want change. They all want to complain about James Dolan. But then look at this. Why the hell would James Dolan even consider selling part of this team? It would make no sense. So between the Garden and between their quote-unquote knowledgeable fan base that likes watching bad basketball, I guess. They're so knowledgeable, they'll just go watch anything. So knowledgeable. But again, this goes back to Knicks fans, you want James Dolan out so bad, this is your fault that he's staying around. Look at this. And these idiots that want James Dolan out gloat about this report. He's not leaving, you dummies, because of this. Because of this, he can keep strumming his guitar at any stupid nightclub in New York City, playing bad music all he wants, because you fools continue to buy his jerseys, continue to sell out the Garden for a 17-30 team, and continue to think that every single guy you draft is terrible the night you draft him, and then the second coming the day you see training camp. So that's my side caveat.
Man.
And I had to get it out there because, you know, it's fine to see Matt gloat on Colton, you know, Personal Foul Podcast, Colton Gesser, big Lakers fans, and I'm fine with that. But I just want to make it clear. The Knicks are the most wealthy team because of the Garden first and foremost. And because of stupid fans. You could say loyal. I say dumb. If you're really that loyal to your team, you stop paying for stuff to get a good team again. You could watch them on TV all you want. Just don't buy the tickets. Don't buy the concessions. Don't buy the jerseys. There's no one jersey worthy on that team. I digress, Steve.
Yeah, there's your second rant.
Oh, it felt so good.
And you're tired.
I'm grumpy when I'm tired.
Yeah, I can see that.
You grew up with me. You know how grumpy I can get when I'm tired. I think I used to like kick you when we were playing PlayStation when I was grumpy and just say it was for fun.
Nah, you just be mean.
I was mean. I was very mean. I used to choke slam you and almost kill you.
That's fair. But
anyway, Dave, do you have anything to add to my angry caveat? I think Brooklyn got in there at like number 7.
I didn't look at the whole list.
I think they're ranked at like 2.6 billion.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
To be a top 10 franchise after being from Jersey, which is always one of the lowest ones, shooting up to one of the top 10, not bad.
I mean, they went to Brooklyn. Anytime you're in New York, the market's going to be huge. It's just that simple.
Hey, the Clippers are, I think, a one ahead of them at 6, and the Clippers were always like, yeah, they're Los Angeles, but they're the Clippers.
It's still, listen, I understand it's but they're the Clippers, they're the redheaded stepchild, but still Los Angeles. They're still going to make a lot of money.
That's true, unless it's hockey. And the NHL can't continue to push the Kings because they're not good. Anyway, Dave, do you have anything else to add to this episode?
No, other than apparently we still don't know where Tom Brady's going to go, even though I still think he's going to go to the Patriots.
My prediction for San Diego earlier this year just got juicier with Philip Rivers leaving. And then the fact that Chucky John Gruden wants him over in Oakland.
Did you see the whole Cowboys thing too?
No. Oh, the cat. Yeah, that he might go there. Why would he? That's such a stupid thing. He's not going to the Cowboys. It's the last place he's going to go. The hell does he want that type of pressure for? You know, you go to San Diego, it's sunny. He can go and lay on the beach every time he gets sacked. He'll be cool. He goes to Vegas. It's Vegas, and it's John Gruden, who's an offensive guru. It makes sense. Stays in New England, Belichick. The hell is he going to go to Dallas for?
I don't know.
He might as well just go to the Giants and kick Daniel Jones in the nuts and say, this is my team for 2 years. I'm like, no.
I have no idea. All I'm saying is that Pats are offering him 30 mil a year. And I just feel like
it's not about the money for Tom right now.
It's not. It's not.
It hasn't been about the Since he married Giselle, it has not been about the money. No,
I understand that. I understand that, but he did take the hometown discount before, and now he's not going to, so now they're going to give him what they think he deserves, and he does deserve it. But I just don't see him leaving it. I mean, it could happen. I just don't see it happen.
Dave, are you going to go back to N'Keal Harry, Julian Edelman, who's an injury away from retiring like Wes Welker, a very good defense, but a running game that showed to be kind of shifty, and an offensive line that couldn't block? Is that what you want to go back to at 44 years old about to be?
I don't care.
I care. And Giselle doesn't want to be in the cold anymore.
That's all fair. That's
Giselle
fair.
Rules that damn house.
that is true. That is the main reason I can see for him leaving. Giselle wants to, yeah, I can concede that one.
One of the great, arguably the best quarterback of all time, one of the top five football players of all time, is the secondary income in his household.
Oh, I know.
Picture that. Secondary income.
No, it's just a Jets fan in me. I won't believe it until I actually see it. And I won't believe it until he's actually there in the damn pads. He's not going to pull a Josh McDaniels on me and just say, oh, no, I don't care anymore, and just go back to the Patriots. No, he has to be there. He has to start game one.
Plot twist. If Belichick gets rid of him, he recalls Jacoby Brissett and Jimmy Garoppolo and some ridiculous clause he put in bull trades lets them try out.
I hate you. No, but there are plenty of QBs that are going to be hitting the market, so we'll see what happens.
Ridiculous. Drew Brees in a New England uniform. Book it. It's not happening.
No, it's not happening at all. I don't know what the hell you're talking about.
I think he's available.
No. Oh,
could you imagine? No, Phillip Rivers needs to go back to New York and go to the
Phillip's
Giants.
Available. I think Taysom Hill apparently said something about it.
He's a franchise player. Yeah. Hey, listen, go for it, Taysom Hill. Go for it. Go get your money.
Why the hell not? If you
speak
can get
into
paid.
Existence.
Exactly. Listen, Sam Bradford, Brock Osweiler, they got paid. Get paid, kid. Get paid and get the hell out. There's no reason not
Sam
to.
Bradford has talent. His body just hated him. Okay?
Oh, great, I know. Oh,
greatest,
I know.
Greatest swindle in NFL history. Fitzmagic is getting there, though.
Oh, yeah.
We'll have a whole podcast on who the greatest swindlers in NFL history.
We're going too far now.
All right. We're going to end this show before it gets to an hour of us just making fun of everybody in the NFL. You know, this is what happens when the XFL takes over. We make fun of the NFL until it comes back, and then we're back.
Yeah, the XFL is a real football league.
We're not going to go that far yet.
The X is for extreme.
They have not used that. It's for the love of football, Dave. For the love of football.
I know it is.
But all right, with that.
Oh, sorry. So, no, wait.
Oh, God. Stream of consciousness episode.
I have to include this about the XFL. Did you see the video of the guy lining up for the Houston Roughnecks in the slot
and
vomiting?
So, fun story. I read the story on ESPN about that today because I saw it pop up and I read it. And he's like, man, I've been getting made fun of all week.
Oh, my God, dude.
I've been getting
so
texts.
Funny.
He's like, the players made fun of me. He goes, all it was is the big play happened. I was the first down there. I was excited. I chugged a bottle of orange Gatorade before that. I lined up, and it all came back.
Oh, my God. That was hilarious. He just rallies, too. He was perfectly fine right after it. So.
Oh, it just happened. And then he ran the play. It was a one-point play after that for an extra point. He just ran the route. Like, he did it. And he had a good game. He had a touchdown and five catches, 45 yards. Like, he's not like some scrub guy. We're gonna see him again.
Yeah, and he puked and rallied in the game. So listen, all the props to him. I just thought that was an amazing moment.
And if the XFL tanks, that will be the gif and meme of the whole entire organization. All right, with that, that will actually end this episode of Cuesta Dos. This nice stream of consciousness, rant-heavy episode of Cuesta Dos. I'm Alex Cuesta. Find me on Twitter and Instagram at @_Cuesta30. Find David on Twitter at @DCuesta308, Instagram QuestaCola. Find Sports Opinions on Twitter, SportsOpinion30, Instagram SportsOpinions30. Go search us on Facebook. Anywhere you can listen to a podcast, go search for Sports Opinions Podcast. Not only do we have this episode of Cuesta Dos in this show, we have the Sports Opinions Podcast proper, where I interview a bunch of people. I have Gus Frerotte coming up this week, and hopefully I have some other he was a Redskins quarterback, Vikings quarterback. Hopefully I have some other great guests coming up in the future. I have under the umbrella now, K-Doc has come underneath with We're Young But Just Us, where he just kind of does whatever the hell he wants on that episode. Sports, comics, everything. And then Colton Gesser, Personal Foul Podcast. And the playbook is still dwindling there somewhere with Rob and Joe. Probably once we get into NFL football, they'll come back again. Yeah. They're very busy, and they just haven't had the time to record episodes. But they'll be back. Don't worry, everybody. If you like their show, they will be back. Last but not least, send us emails. sportsopinions30@gmail.com. Like what we do, hate what we do, suggestions, you want guests, you want to be on, send an email. We'd love to hear it from you. All right, Dave, any last words before we say goodbye?
Yeah, you don't need to just send us emails. You can tweet at us. You can do whatever you want. As long as we get to hear it, we'll talk about it, or Alex will have you on.
There we go.
Either one works.
All right, so everybody, I hope you enjoyed this episode of Cuesta Dos. So long, everyone.